recalling an incident in the life of our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that is of unique importance, and importance enough that the first passage of a very profound surah of the Quran is dedicated to that incident. And this involves the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam trying to deliver the message of Islam to the leaders of Quraysh. This is something he was struggling to do for a very long time. And there is a reason for that, because the people of the highest influence, if they were to accept Islam, then that would have a ripple effect. A lot more people would be influenced by their decision, and it would actually spread Islam much, much faster. But the thing is, with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, most of his career, the leaders of Quraysh were adamantly against anything he had to say. So on one rare occasion, what happens is one of the leaders of Quraysh, and it's interesting to note, we're not sure who it is. Different Sahaba have different opinions about who it is. It could have been Utbah, it could have been Abu Jahl, it could have been any number of them. Anyway, at one occasion, instead of making fun of the Prophet or ﷺ or debating with him or dismissing him, it's one of those rare cases where they're actually listening to him. So he's speaking with them outside and they're actually listening. And while they're engaged in this conversation, one of the relatives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whose name is Abdullah ibn Maktum, he's related to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by marriage, so he's cousins with Khadija radiallahu anha, and he's very poor man, and he's one of the earliest people to accept Islam. This is all happening in Mecca. He happened to be passing by, and an important thing about Abdullah is that he's blind, so he can't see, and he's passing by, and he, of course, when people are blind, then they have much higher sensitive hearing. So from kind of a distance, he hears the voice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's no other way for him to know where the Prophet is except by his voice. And as I told you, the Prophet is at this time sallallahu alaihi wasallam engaged in a rare opportunity. He's talking to the leaders of Quraysh, and they're actually listening for a change. And so he's in the middle of this conversation, and he comes rushing over to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who happens to be his cousin also. And it's interesting, in one narration he says, "Ya Muhammad arshidni, Muhammad, give me some guidance. Tell me something good." In another narration he says, "Allimni mimma 'allamaka Allah, teach me something that Allah taught you." Analyze what he's saying. He's not saying that I have an emergency and I need help right away. He's not saying that I have a situation, I need your urgent advice. He just happened to hear the Prophet's voice. He got excited. He, you know, rushed over to the Prophet and said, "Can you tell me something good, please? Because I just really want to hear something motivating, something spiritual." That's what he's saying. But the Prophet ﷺ is right now engaged in another conversation. He's already talking to somebody who he may never get a chance to talk to again. And even if he does, that opportunity may not be the same, because for a change, they're actually listening. So now the Prophet ﷺ is stuck. He doesn't want to break Abdullah's heart and say, "Could you hold on a second? Let me finish this conversation." And he doesn't want to lose the chance of speaking to this leader also. So what the Prophet ﷺ does is something completely ingenious. He, as he's in this tension, he turns slightly to the leader that he was speaking to, and he says to him, "Hal tara bima aqulu ba'san? Do you see any problem in what I've been sharing with you?" So he didn't really respond to Abdullah yet. He talked to the leader of Quraysh and said, "Hey, so I've been talking to you for a while. Anything I've said so far, do you have any problem with it?" Basically. Now why did he do that? One, it solves the problem for Abdullah. Abdullah now realizes, wait, I'm interrupting a conversation. I didn't realize I was interrupting a conversation. And at that point, Abdullah's reaction is supposed to be, "Rasulullah, I didn't realize you're talking to somebody else. I just got excited. Why don't you just finish your conversation? I'll ask you later. My thing is not urgent, it can wait." So the Prophet wouldn't have to tell him, "You need to wait, just give me a couple of seconds," because that might be hurtful to him. But he tried to tell him in a very indirect and polite way. At the same time, he's trying to get to the leader of Quraysh and saying, "Listen, I'm not dismissing you, so don't go anywhere." You know, so he's kind of trying to mitigate both of these situations, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, the other thing I want to share with you is, scholars like Al-Qurtubi, Imam Razi, others, when they talk about this this incident, they at length describe what Abdullah ibn Maktum did wrong. Like I said, if he's blind, certainly it's an indication in the story that he's got very sharp hearing. And if he's got sharp hearing, not only did he hear the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he also heard the other that was speaking. And the other that was speaking, whoever it was, definitely was a famous person in Mecca. It's a leader, it's a millionaire, it's somebody's big deal. Which means Abdullah ibn Maktum, high chances are, also recognized who that was. But he still didn't regard that. It's just because to him, the Prophet ﷺ is not only the messenger, it's also his relative. And he just got excited and interrupted the conversation. So the first wrong that was done was actually done by Abdullah ibn Maktum. Like, if two of you are talking and I interrupt the conversation and say salam to one of you and pretend the other one doesn't even exist and just start talking, that's rude. But on the other hand, also understand something else. Understand that people like Abdullah ibn Maktum are very excited and truly, truly motivated to learn something beneficial. You may not see it as a state of emergency, but for them, learning anything of benefit is, they're so eager to learn it and they're so excited about it. When he hears the Prophet's voice sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's so excited that he forgets everything else. He forgets what other sounds he hears. He forgets everything else that's going on. He just really wants to learn something of benefit. And this is an incredible, incredible sentiment that Allah put inside the heart of a believer, that they're so excited and eager to learn something of benefit. So the Prophet ﷺ, in this tense moment, here's what he did. The verb for it is abas. Abasa means qattaba bayna aynayhi, to show a bulge between both eyes. Like just this bulge between the eyes. If it goes a little further, if you start showing lines on the forehead and your teeth start grinding like you're frustrated, that's called kalah. And if you're so frustrated that you do something obnoxious on top of that, that's actually called basar with a seen. Like abasa wa basar, right? The least demonstration of being tense, being frustrated on your face is abasa. The surah begins abasa wa tawalla. He frowned and he turned away. The Prophet ﷺ showed that frustration on his face and he turned away. Now the question arises, who did he frown at? He didn't frown at anyone, he frowned at the situation. That's why Allah doesn't even mention that he frowned at a person. But the other thing is, if you were watching this, just imagine for a second there's a governor that the Prophet is talking to, everybody knows the governor, and there's some blind guy, who's the one that everybody recognizes? The governor. And if you saw the Prophet turning towards the governor, the journalist would write down, he turned towards the governor. Nobody's gonna write down, he turned away from the blind guy. In other words, by saying the words abasa wa tawalla, Allah actually acknowledged the blind one and completely dismissed the governor. Like to Allah, the VIP is the other one. It's not this one. And the even more incredible thing is when Quran is revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, because they say, فَنَزَلَتْ, at the very moment where the Prophet said, do you see a problem with what I've shared with you so far? At the very moment these ayat were revealed to the Prophet ﷺ. And when the ayat are revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, he doesn't keep them to himself. He what? He recites them out loud. So there's two people in front of him, this blind person and this leader, and in front of both of them, the Prophet is saying, he frowned and he turned away. Like he's critiquing himself in front of them. It's an incredible moment. And then Allah says, أَنْجَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى, that the blind one had come to him. Why did Allah call him the blind one? The way to look at this is, Allah Azza wa Jal is acknowledging that this man has a visual impairment, he's disabled, and despite being disabled, he sought you out. He should get extra courtesy from you. His blindness actually became kind of a gold medal for him. Like Allah acknowledging the effort and the struggle that it took for him to come to the Prophet ﷺ. أَنْجَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى. أَنْجَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى is Allah acknowledging the one with disability. And actually telling the Rasul of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that even the slightest bit of, well, he wasn't even dismissing him yet, but the standards are so high. This is how sensitive you're supposed to be as the Messenger of Allah, to set the example of how careful you must be around these VIPs of Allah. These are very important people to Allah. You know, I'm not even done with the story yet, but I'll tell you one, I'll fast forward to one part of this story. Later on in the life of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, every time Abdullah came by, every time this man came by, marhaban, marhaban bihi, marhaban biman atabani Allahu bihi. Congratulations, you know, I welcome the one. Allah, I got in trouble with Allah because of you. I gotta be extra careful with you. And he was saying it jokingly. Every time he came, he would actually stop everything he was doing, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he would say, you know, hal ilayka bihaja, do you have any need at all? Anything you need at all? Can I get you anything? Anything at all? And he'd like go out of his way to ask him. And as he would leave a gathering, he'd do that again. Ask him again. Everything okay? Everything okay? Everything okay? Why? Because by the end of this passage, you know what Allah said? Allah said to the Messenger, فَأَنْتَ عَنْهُ تَلَهَا. And you, Messenger of Allah, you get to be distracted from him? How did you get distracted from him? And this is actually something the Messenger lived his entire life. He was never distracted from Abdullah bin Maktoum again. Any gathering he came to, he gave him special time and attention. A few favorite things about this passage is there were two individuals in front of the Prophet. A governor, a leader, and this individual. Allah started the surah by saying this individual is so elite in his status that when the Prophet ﷺ does not give him the proper courtesy that is required to him, by Allah's standards, by the Prophet's standards, he did nothing wrong. Understand that. Even if the Prophet was frustrated just a little bit and there was a frown on his face, can a blind person see a frown? Even if the Prophet turned his face this way and talked to the leader of Quraysh, can the blind person see him turning his face? He can't. He didn't hurt his feelings. But by Allah's standards, even that's too much. Because somebody watching from a distance, somebody seeing this incident from 100 feet away might think, oh, the Prophet thinks that the governor is more important and the blind one's less important. You can't even afford to give that impression. Not only must you treat him special, you can't even give that impression to anybody else, whether he found offense in it or not. So now, after this acknowledgement of Abdullah ibn Maktoum, by the way, what an incredible passage to acknowledge his, I mean, before this day, when somebody called him blind, it would be an insult. And now it's become an accolade for him, something that makes him noble. Allah took the most noble human being, the busiest human being, and the human being with the most important mission ever given, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and said, you should have special care for him. Can you imagine? This entire ummah has special consideration for Rasulullah, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is told to have special consideration for Abdullah ibn Maktum. Look at that. Just on account of the effort he made. But on the other side, you know, when somebody, this is true about a lot of people that suffer from disability or have that kind of a life, they don't have access in society that like the rest of us, so they're not part of social gatherings like the rest of us. They're not in part of normal conversations. People act strange around them. They don't talk normally around them. People who know them do, but if they're in a new gathering, people keep staring at their, you know, their missing hand, or their skin disorder, or their eyes going the other way, or whatever. People kind of look at them funny, you know? And therefore, they're not able to have normal social interactions like other people do. These people actually have to go out of their way to struggle to get the attention that they deserve. And a lot of times, people like that, you might consider them socially awkward. Like a blind person may be unusually loud, it may happen. They're just unusually loud because they need to make their presence known, and they don't know how else. When the Prophet ﷺ is speaking to the leader of Quraysh, and he's being interrupted by his cousin, he could tell his cousin, listen, we're family, you have access to me, you can come any other time. And he's not saying that either, but at least he might even be thinking, you and I might even be thinking, you know, you could just wait a little bit. I mean, I know you can't see, but you can hear. You know I'm in a different conversation. But Allah Azza wa Jalla says, you have to acknowledge his excitement. وَمَا يُدْرِكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّى أَوْ يَذَّكَّرُ فَتَنْفَعُهُ الذِّكْرَى. What clue do you have? You have no way of knowing. Maybe he came to you because he really wants to become a better person. He wants to cleanse himself. And if he's not ready to transform himself right away, at the very least, what you tell him will be a reminder, and that reminder might benefit him down the road. Maybe he doesn't change right away. أَوْ يَذَّكَّرُ فَتَنْفَعَهُ الذِّكْرَى يعني فيما بعد. Maybe he'll take the reminder now, and maybe later on he'll benefit from it. And this is his side, like Allah comes to his defense. You don't know, maybe he came for good intentions. Overlook the rudeness. Overlook the obnoxiousness. Overlook the dismissal of the other. Just be extra courteous to him anyway. That's what Allah is telling the Prophet. Now what about the leader? What about him? Because if you're going to give him benefit of the doubt, you should give the leader benefit of the doubt. Allah says, أَمَّا مَنْ إِسْتَغْنَى As for the one who in his heart feels like he has no need for your message. Istighna is an analysis of what goes inside a person. Istighna is not on the outside. Istighna, the Arabic word, is on the inside. The man who feels like he has no need. How would the Prophet know the man has no need? He was paying attention to the Prophet. He was actually having a conversation with him. Allah says, let me diagnose his heart for you. He's got nothing going on in there. He has no care for your message. He's just stringing you along. فَأَنْتَ لَهُ تَصَدَّى And for him, you are going to keep going back and back to him and back to him and back to him and relentlessly pursuing him. Don't do that. He doesn't deserve it. Now Allah spoke about two individuals, didn't he? He spoke about Abdullah and he spoke about that leader. And when he spoke about Abdullah, he called him Al-A'ma, the blind one, like Allah knows him. And the leader, Allah said, someone, man istaghna. As for somebody who acts like they don't care, you know, like Allah made him a nobody. Allah made the governor a nobody. And even though Allah has already mentioned Abdullah, he mentioned him again. How did he do so? وَأَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى وَهُوَ يَخْشَى فَأَنْتَ عَنْهُ تَلَهُ And as for the one who came to you running, he came to you running. And he's full of fear while he comes to you running. The fact that he came from a long distance, the fact that it took him a lot of effort to get there, got acknowledged by Allah. There's an effort involved. And in it, Allah acknowledges the efforts of all those who try to learn something about the deen, especially those that struggle despite their disability to learn something about their deen. Those that are going through pain, internal pain, physical pain, you know, bodily defects, whatever they're going through, and yet despite all of that, they're trying to learn Allah's deen. Those people have been acknowledged in أَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى And then Allah stamps the approval of what goes on inside his heart and says, وَهُوَ يَخْشَى And he in fact is the one that's fearful. The last thing I want to share with you here is yet again an accolade given to this individual. In the surah before this one, this is Surah Abasa. In the surah before this one, Allah described Musa went to the Pharaoh. Musa went to Fir'aun. And Fir'aun he was asked for one thing. وَأَهْدِيَكَ إِلَى رَبِّكَ فَتَخْشَى I might guide you to your master, maybe you'll be afraid. Maybe you'll become a person of khashya. But instead of becoming a person of khashya, ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ يَسْعَى later on. He started running the other way. He planned against the Prophet Musa, turned his back and made efforts against the deen. So there are two verbs there. He was supposed to be fearful and tragically, he made efforts against the deen. And the opposite of that is Abdullah ibn Maktum, who runs towards the Prophet ﷺ, and جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى وَهُوَ يَخْشَى And he's fearful. In other words, one of the most powerful political leaders in human history, Fir'aun is a nobody to Allah, and the success story to Allah is this blind man who came to the Prophet ﷺ. Quran is teaching us that these are VIPs of Allah. These are important people to Allah. And those of them that are believers and are struggling to learn, even if they may become socially awkward, irritable, that may be the case. Overlook all of that. If your messenger is told to overlook all of it, then who are you and I? May Allah Azza wa Jal give us the kind of sensitivity we're supposed to carry, that Allah's book teaches, and truly make us live the legacy of our dear messenger ﷺ.